last time. On the group. But it's not clear at this point how large this group is. So how do we construct such a different model? So the question is, how do we construct how large this group? How large? It could be empty. So how do we construct such a different morphemes? And here comes this the classical mechanics, the idea from classical mechanics. So one of the way of finding a constructing a simplicity different morphism is by considering the flow of so-called Hamilton's equation. So how did it? Here it is. So consider the let is H most common. And when you give a smooth function, you can take the differential. Yeah? If you consider this differential, so this differential is a one form. And we are given a two form omega. So one way of obtaining one form out of two form is to take the integer product with some data point. So consider these algebraic equations for this vector field. X that solves this equation. X interior product with omega. But I'm not so sure whether how familiar you are in this notation. What this means is nothing but that's my usual notation, but or you can think of omega is two form, you take this, you insert x in the first spot and you leave the second spot open, and then this define a one form. So you ask whether this one form is the be the same as this different. That's what I mean by this algebraic. And here comes the non-degeneracy. The non-degeneracy of omega implies there is a unique solution for solving this equation. Provides, give rise to unique solutions. Unique solutions X for that equation. You just solve it. You regard. Well, the non-degeneracy, another way of stating this non-degeneracy is the following. So this non-degeneracy of omega is equivalent to saying that this, the map, and D, so the D is tangent vector of n and x and maps to this one form, omega at x, and you carry this d. And this is a element in the cotangent space of n. So non-degeneracy of this two form means it's equivalent to saying that this linear map is isomorphic. So which we usually denote omega tilde, for the x, is an isomorphism. So therefore, this provides a unique vector field. You solve that equation at each given point, so that provides a unique vector field that solves that equation. And this x is called, this unique x is called frequent vector. This unique vector field, the vector field X solving this equation is called Hamiltonian vector. Associated to this smooth function.
that summit.
And then when you're given the effort, when you're given a vector field, you can think of this ordinary differential equation given by this, the vector field. And so this gives rise to, so what we are interested in, the main, the one of the interest, so to construct some, so and then, the flow of this XH, so meaning that the flow or more generally, solutions define some isotope of the moment. So if it exists, so here comes something you have to worry about, so whether that differential equation, ordinary differential equation, is integral, integrates to a flow. So for that purpose, I'm going to assume M is compact. So for example, define an isotopy of different modes. So if n is compact, you don't know these flows give you this. So if n is compact, so let the assume n is compact. You got a boundary. And then this statement is precise. And the claim is that these flows, flows define an isotopy of simplicity. And actually, for the later purpose, I want to consider the non-autonomous ordinary differential equations. This is time-independent differential equations. So sometimes we need to consider time-dependent this analog of that one. So more generally, we consider the time-dependent functions h from r to m to r, so which are known as the time-dependent functions. So in this simplicity geometries, smooth functions is sometimes called Hamiltonian, very often called Hamiltonian, and the time-dependent function is called time-dependent Hamiltonian. And the associated is time dependent ordinary differential equations, so the HTS. And by the uniqueness and existence theorem of ordinary differential equations, this also defines some flow. And the flow, so here is the general proposition. The flow which we usually denote by T of capital H. This is simplified. So this proposition tells you that this group of simplified diffeomorphism is as large as the space of functions, the space of time between the functions. So here is the given proof of this. So we want to prove that the proba of omega is omega. And here is some, usually when you are given some isolated object, it is very hard to deal with. And luckily, in this case, you are given one kind of the family of these different morphisms. So to prove that kind of identity, we just differentiate. And we know that the constant function. So you know, what are you proving? A function is constant. We just differentiate and prove that the different derivative vanishes. So to prove that identity, you are going to prove it's a differentiated version. So then obviously when t equals 0, phi 0 h is just identity. So therefore that identity is obviously holds. So phi 0 h omega is obviously omega. So therefore, to prove that identity, we are going to prove its derivative is 0. So to prove phi t h of omega is omega, for all t, we are going to prove the derivative vanishes. T by t h of omega is 0 for all t. And here you have to be familiar with this exterior differential calculus. So I will assume you are all familiar with this exterior differential calculus. So let's compute. So, but what is this? dTb over omega. And one of the very important formula in this business, so-called Poisson's magic formula, which relates the Lie derivative with to some interior part. So you're going to apply this Cardan's magic formula, which basically says the Lie derivative of general form with respect to x is the exterior derivative of omega plus x or d omega. Right? That's the general Cardan's magic formula. However, by the definition of simplified form, d of omega vanishes. So for the simplified form, this term is right. So therefore, this one is nothing but taking the Lie derivative of omega with respect to associated vector field. So the general formula for this derivative is this one. And then you take the Lie derivative of x h t of omega. Okay. That's the general formula in differential manifold course. Then I apply this Cardan's magic formula. You see that xt, xht of omega of d and plus of xht of d omega. But this one is zero because omega is closed. On the other hand, so let me write this up. This one is zero as d omega is zero. On the other hand, the d of ht of omega. So by definition of Hamiltonian vector field, this is nothing but a d of ht by definition. By definition of Hamiltonian vector field. XHT. So therefore, this is zero too. So this shows as this derivative of these two forms is zero for all t. So the initial condition is satisfied, and its derivative vanishes. So the that proof is by TH is indeed simple.
So you have the initial condition for H. Why here when T is zero, then why T naught and the pi naught is zero?
Why not? Yeah. This is just.
I mean, when t is 0, so you have some function, right?
Yeah.
But the y judge.
The function is h 0. I don't need any, just h 0 is any function. So pi 0 is just initial condition. So, yeah. Pi 0 h means identity. It's just the solving the ordinary differential equations. And the flow by definition, the initial condition is x0 is x. And then you solve it.
So you have to have some. And t varies, then the Hamiltonian varies.
Yeah.
Right. So you have to have some function. It depends on you on the x.
T. Depends on t and x, yeah.
I mean, when t is 0.
So this one, this you should look at, this is time, non-autonomous ordinary differential equation. So the solution, the flow of any ordinary differential equations start from the identity. Initially, it's identity, the move. Right? Maybe I was flow. Let me record what the flow of. Right? Suppose you're given this time-dependent vector field in general. And what is the meaning of flow? The flow of this non-autonomous ordinary differential equation means it's the collection of solutions. Cartesian curve, integral curve. So this, in other words, the flow of phi t x means the definition of this is just x t x in the gamma of t with the initial condition at x. Gamma is the integral curve with the initial condition x. Where gamma t is gamma t x. With initial conditions gamma 0 x is x. So
I mean, what are
the biggest confusion since you were the same, you're using the same t for the function h and the flow t.
So the other thing.
You're writing h from r cross n to r is a function in t and s.
Right. So maybe my notation is a little confusing. Okay. So let's start off the notation. So I look at so this is a notation. Okay? So h sub t is a function on n. And my notation is phi t h is the flow of that time-dependent Hamiltonian. The phi notation is phi t h together is the flow of this family of vectors. Which are denoted as h t x is x h sub t of time. For each fixed time t, you apply that solve that equation. And then we define this vector field, one vector field. And you look at this family, this is a time dependent family.
So that's another t, right? So h sub t is, let's say h sub f. So f parameterized the Hamiltonian.
And it's the same t. So my flow at the initial time is always identity by definition. So we are looking at the initial point x. And flow is basically that you move around this initial condition. And you look at the time t point for the associated integral curve. Here is the integral curve. And here is phi. So, and then you move this. So this whole thing, that's why it's called flow. At time, so if your originally this is f, then it moves 5 here. So the flow is the whole collection of integral curves for different initial conditions. You collect them all, it defines a different maximum for each.
So superscript t is from the the differential equation, right?
Yes.
And the subscript T is parameterized the Hamiltonian.
Right. So the point is the autonomous, the non-autonomous differential equation is that parameter is associated with this T itself.
So they are the same.
Yeah.
That's what you said.
Any other question? I mean, it's confusing, actually. It's not, this is your first encounter with a non-autonomous ordinary differential equation. So in this way, you see that the conclusion is, so therefore, is the conclusions. Oh, by the way, so well, the conclusion is that this for each time dependent functions, so this infinite of r plus m, we are given this whole family of one part of the family. By TH of simpler behavior models. So this SIMP, so therefore, this SIMP of M omega is as big as this spatial function. So this tells you that this is infinite dimensional group. This is infinite dimensional. It's a fairly large group. So when you're given some geometric structure like simplex form, and this, the holomorphism group basically tells you how flexible the geometric structure is. So this tells you that this the simplex structure is very flexible. The simplex geometry is very flexible geometry in this regard. So if you compare this fact, right now, I'm assuming M is compact. But this discussion can be carried out for non-compact case if your Hamiltonian sort of has nice behavior in it, so that you can integrate this ordinary differential equation. You know the word is elliptic. To solve ordinary differential equation, you need some kind of implicit condition to solve. So if you impose that kind of condition at infinity, this whole discussion can be applied to non-compact case. Okay, so now, but this family of diffeomorphisms is quite special. What is the special? Okay. This one, but that's one conclusion. So here is a proposition. The question is, suppose X is a vector field, general vector field, on this simplicity manifold from lambda. You may ask, when is the flow of this vector field simplicity? And here is the answer. So X is the flow of X is symplectic if and only if this integral product omega this is the one form. And if this form is closed, then you can check its flow is going to be simpler. So let phi t be the flow of this x. Okay, again, to prove this symplectic, let's differentiate. So we differentiate. Is two forms come back. Again, by the same idea, we know the phi zero star omega is omega. Now we differentiate. The phi t, the family, this is one part of the family is symplectic. We can only this vanishes. Right? So we have to check whether this vanishes. We have to check when this vanishes. But this one, again, by the same magic formulas, this is the same as the lead derivative of omega. Again, by t star of, this is the integral product of x, omega, plus the second term vanishes, and the middle to right. Okay, so therefore, from this expression, you see that the hence this left hand side vanishes if and only if this vanishes. So we have proved that property. So in this regard, we know so we have proven that this Hamiltonian vector field is symplectic, right? But this Hamiltonian vector field is more special than this one. So for the case of Hamiltonian vector field, what we know is this differentials x h of omega is not only closed, it is exact. So in this case, this form is exact. by the subset, and omega is the collection of time on that of all possible Hamiltonians. So H is time, so C infinite of, let's say, 0, 1. So you have shown that this is solving a subset of symplectic diffeomorphisms, right? So this is called is Hamiltonian, the set of Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms. This phi on H is called such phi on H in general is called Hamiltonian diffeomorphism. Hamiltonian diffeomorphism is some particular case of the symplectic diffeomorphism. So how do they distinguish? Means it can be written as Hamiltonian vector field of the smooth function H, if and only if this is dPi. So the corresponding Hamiltonian is just the potential of that closed dPi model. This is quite obvious. Moment, it's not clear whether this really forms a group. It's a certain subset of this symplectic diffeomorphism group. So the claim is this subset indeed forms a group, subgroup. But let me, before going on, I want to give you some impressions, to give you some feeling about this difference between general Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms and symplectic diffeomorphisms. You can easily, by the way, the difference between exact and closed disappears. Exact one form and closed one form disappears if manifold is simply connected. So the difference only arises when the manifold is not simply or H1 is not zero. So let's look at these two torus. It's the M. Two torus. Two Z4 with the standard area form. Curve here, and if you translate, this curve moves that in the sky. I claim this property is displacing the surface property. This property characterizes the difference between and characterizes the property that this rotation is not cannot be Hamiltonian diffeomorphism. The claim is. Maybe I would say this Hamilton, this family is not Hamilton, none of these are Hamiltonian. So suppose it is Hamilton.
It's a twofold environment.
So I think maybe I can prove this. Okay. So maybe I don't need this. So let's try to. Let's go back to the definition. Suppose it is Hamiltonian. Suppose phi is r phi 0 is Hamiltonian. So by definition of this Hamiltonian, diffeomorphisms or definitions is r phi 0 should be time on map of some Hamiltonian for some function h. Time on images here. So we integrate, we compute so this area from 0 to 1. I'm trying to compute this area, so let's try to integrate meridian circle and parameterize. You see, by a curve, let's see, it's gamma from this unit circle to this C. And then consider this gamma as a map from 0, 1 cross S1 into this torus, and defined by gamma Ts is defined by phi t of h of this gamma s. So what I'm doing is I'm looking at this motion of this circle, original circle, this curve. So this sort of defines some two-dimensional surface. So I'm going to integrate. And the initial, you note that this gamma 0, gamma t 0 is our original circle C, gamma t. And that's our, on the other hand, gamma t1 is phi 1h of gamma 1. But phi 1h is assumed to be that r phi 0 of gamma t and gamma t. Well, this is sort of connected curve, so whatever you do, this under that flow, this maybe wanders around, and the point is that the initial condition is DC, and then it wanders around, and finally you end up here. Okay? So this curve, so we compute this integral, so the pullback of 0, 1 cross S1 of secure what it is. So this one, by definition, 0, 1, plus S1, omega of D gamma of DT of D gamma DS. Zero one of S one of B S D T. Well, if 0 1 0 S 1 omega, what is D gamma D T? D gamma D T, there is D gamma D T. So if you differentiate with respect to t, you get, if you differentiate with respect to t, you get the Hamiltonian vector field. This is flow of Hamiltonian. So you see that this one, that's h of t gamma ts. On the other hand, differentiate with respect to f, you get d of phi th of gamma prime s and ds dt. So let me write one more line. 0, 1 of s1 of omega, let's say it's t, phi th of gamma s, and then d phi th of gamma prime s of ds dt. And then substitute it by T of H of gamma S, and then you evaluate against this Hamiltonian D by T H of gamma prime of S of D S D T. Maybe my notation is maybe confused, so why don't I write T?
Maybe I refrain myself with T too many times.
So that's just T, the differential of the map. But you know, by the chain rule, this is nothing but 0, 1, S1, of B of HT composed with the phi T of H evaluated gamma prime S B S D T. Right? But this is 0, 1, S1 of D S B of HT phi T H gamma S. Yes. But you know, this is circle, so this is zero. here I computed this to be zero, assuming that this rotation alpha is zero is a Hamiltonian diffeomorphism. Okay. On the other hand, this is impossible. This is not possible because in this two-dimensional picture here, our original circle is here, and our original final circle is here. And this integral should be the area of this part, which is not zero. Should be the same as the geometric area. I computed here. I just computed this integral as a integral of two forms over this surface gamma. So the gamma itself, the image could be overlapped many times, but all this overlapping will be canceled. The final. Value should be the same as this area. Why this geometric area? I mean by geometric area of this. So at the moment I do not have a good explanation. So I give you this homework. So this explanation. So what I'm trying to say is that here is there. So here is very important remark. Yes. This kind of intersection properties is a typical property of this Hamiltonian diffeomorphism. It's a very it highlights the difference between the non-Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms and Hamiltonian diffeomorphisms. The point is, any Hamiltonian diffeomorphism, the circle C with this phi 1 h of C is always known as for any Hamiltonian, On the other hand, this rotation is. So gamma is a map at the moment. It's not a different option. Gamma is a map from here on here. So it's not quite clear why this So this kind of interplay between this particular curve and the Hamiltonian vector morphism is one of the most important subject of study in this simplex geometry. So there are two objects involved here. This interplay. Between this Hamiltonian vector morphism phi h, Hamiltonian vector morphism phi on h, and this object you see, this particular curve, the kind of curve c is the crux of in simplex geometry. So what is it so special about this particular curve I chose here? I chose this curve C. And this is, in these examples, it's a non-contractible curve. But that kind of property certainly does not hold if you choose contractible curve. So if we consider this, let's say there is curve like this, this C, another C prime, a contractible curve, small curve, C prime, and this intersection property does not hold even if you choose Hamiltonian vector morphism. So that intersection property fails to hold. Even for Hamiltonian vector morphism. Between the Hamiltonian vector morphism and symplectic vector morphism. But there are still some difference between the family of curves. So you compare this with case with the case of spheres, which is reflected. I told you that if you choose a small circles, that intersection property fails. But this equator, if you choose equator, that intersection property still remains the case. So in that case, so there are two kind of families. There are small circles. And this area bisecting. Bisecting surface. So there is a similarity here. The area bisecting circle on a sphere and this non-contractible circles in torus, they have this kind of similar property of under the action of this Hamiltonian vector morphism. question. So, for the remaining minute, now I want to give the proof of the fact that the set of Hermitian diffeomorphisms indeed forms a proof. So here is the theorem. This M of M omega in general, M omega is a subgroup. So here is the by the way, this proof involves very important calculation in simplex geometries. You will see this proof is quite interesting. So let's see. So what do we have to prove? We need to prove first, obviously, identity is contained in hand, so I don't need to prove anything. And if this phi is in M and omega, then phi inverse is also in M and omega. Right? That's one thing we need to prove to say that this M and omega is a subgroup. The second thing is if phi and psi lies in M and omega, and then this composition is also in M. So let's try to give the proof of each of these using the definition of Hamiltonian diffeomorphism. First, consider the case one. Well, by definition, there exists some Hamiltonian, time-dependent Hamiltonian, H. R, such that this phi can be written as phi 1 H. So to prove phi inverse is contained in this hand, we again need to find some Hamiltonian which generates this diffeomorphism. So let's, for convenience notation, when this holds, I just write H generates this diffeomorphism phi. Let's use this notation. So to prove phi inverse is also contained in M and omega, we need to find some time-dependent functions which generate this phi inverse. Well, how do we? So we need to find some time-dependent Hamiltonian K or F and such that this F generates phi inverse. So how do we find such a function? Right? I'm going to write down this function explicitly in terms of H. So let's try to say, suppose F is generated by inverse. We don't know what F is at the moment. At least suppose what kind of properties this function capital F must satisfy. actually what I'm going to do is I'm going to construct some function. So we want to construct this function actually. Suppose this not only actually, but let's assume for more. I'm going to construct such that this phi Hamiltonian flow of F is exactly this inverse flow of capital H. So if we find such an F, then this will be automatic. So this is always the case. It is very difficult to prove some isolated instant, but if you have this whole family, you want to prove some one part of the family of identity, it's easier, but because that allows us to differentiate. So what you are going to do is you are going to differentiate. So in other words, this condition means if you compose by P H, so let's say right compose by T H is identity for all. Maybe I do with the other. May be a little bit uncomfortable to differentiate this family of different morphisms. So by differentiating this family, you differentiate these curves. Okay? So you fix a point F, you change T. This is just some curve on the manifold. So what you are doing is you take the tangent vector of that curve. So let's differentiate at each point x. Right? If you differentiate this flow, you get x h t. Phi t h or phi t f x. So that's the result when you differentiate the first is family. And then you have to add up by chain rule. So you need to differentiate the second one. So when you do that, you apply the chain rule, the P of H. And then you differentiate this. If you differentiate this, this is Hamiltonian, you will obtain this Hamiltonian vector field, X, F, P. Evaluate it. Is phi p f x. Okay. That's supposed to be zero because this is identity, so it does not depend on time p. Okay. So now let's unlabel what this identity means. Okay. So let's apply the inverse of derivative. So this will give you that T phi T H, I can rewrite inverse of X H T of phi T of H phi T F X plus X F T of phi T F x equals 0. idea is I look at this equation and multiply the inverse of derivative. That's how you get this one. Since this is supposed, we want this to be true for all x, and phi t of x is different of them. So I can replace this phi t of fx by y. So that identity means, as a vector field, so since x is arbitrary, we require like this identity holds for all x arbitrary, and phi tf is supposed to be a different morphism. This identity means this is true t phi t h inverse of x h t of phi t h of y cross x f t of y equals 0 for all y. Okay. So in other words, as a vector field, i.e., as a vector field, this xf should be, xft should be the same as this one by th inverse of xht of composed by t of h. But what is this? This is precisely the pullback of the vector field. So this is precisely the pullback of vector field of x h t. So what I prove here, if this f generates that whole flow, inverse flow, this F should be the Hamiltonian generating this pullback of this Hamiltonian, original Hamiltonian vector. So, therefore, this F should be the functions whose Hamiltonian vector field should be the function is that for that vector field should be this value. And here is a question you made. Well, something is wrong. Negative, right? Negative. And here is a question. We look at the Hamiltonian vector field, and then take the pullback by this different motion. If this is not Hamiltonian vector field, there is no way to find this function f. So the truth is that this is always a Hamiltonian vector. So let's lemma. State the lemma. Propositions. That is lemma. This is the general lemma. In general, if phi psi is a symplectic different morphism, and omega, and you pull back the vector field, Hamiltonian vector field, x h, and this is always Hamiltonian vector field. Actually, it corresponds to Hamiltonian is nothing but this composition of this function. So this tells you that this Hamiltonian vector field, Hamiltonian diffeomorphism, is preserved under the Fourier operation. So the corollary is this Hamiltonian and omega. So the in particular, this is itself is Hamiltonian. This one itself is always Hamiltonian. Whose corresponding Hamiltonian is nothing but H composed by itself. So using that lemma, you can explicitly write down what the function is. So this function f t should be the negative of this one. So the negative of h t composed with the phi t h. So that's the formula. So in other words, the inverse flow is generated by this kind of Hamiltonian. So this, if H is known, and this is a known function, because if H is known, you can integrate the Hamiltonian vector field, so you can know what this Hamiltonian flow is, and then you take it. So, this proves, so hence, the phi inverse is nothing but phi 1 f with f, the function at tx is negative of h t of phi t h x. So this is one very important formula. So I want to finish composition. There's another. Now let's look at the second. The idea is the same. You're going to differentiate. So you want to find if there is, which generate the flow t goes to phi t h composed by t k, where phi is phi 1h, and psi is phi 1k. Okay. My assumption was phi and psi lies in Hamiltonian diffeomorphism group. So there must be some Hamiltonian h, and for some k, which can be written, which write phi and psi as time of that. For some h and k. So to find this Hamiltonian, again, we are going to differentiate this flow. Again, differentiate. Let's differentiate. Dt by t h and by t k x. Again, by the same idea we as before, we get Hamiltonian vector field, and then by t h by t k x. Then Okay, so now, what is this? So I'm going, what I'm going to do, I'm going to multiply the derivative of phi t at inverse and then t phi t. So I'm going to rewrite this in the following form, phi t h and t phi t h inverse x h t phi t h phi t k x plus x k t phi t k x. So this can be written as t isotopy of this diffeomorphisms. So what is the formula for the corresponding vector field? The vector field is the vector field X generating this flow is given by